we fought World War I in Europe, and we fought World War II in Europe, and we would be just as happy to fight World War III in Europe rather than in the United States.
If nuclear war comes to Britain, this aircraft will be among the first to take off. It's one of four military Boeing 707s kept on round-the-clock alert at an American airbase in East Anglia, a flying war room from which the battle will be directed. It's also a symbol of the American military presence, which has increasingly dominated Britain since the end of World War II. The first Americans to come back to Britain after the war arrived in 1948. Since then, their numbers have grown as steadily as the size of their aircraft. The giant C-5 has brought thousands through RAF Mildenhall, their gateway to Britain. But the build-up has never been debated in public. Much of what they do here and the facilities they use is kept secret. Take Mildenhall itself. It's known simply as the American Third Air Force headquarters in Britain. But when we were filming there, this aircraft suddenly touched down. It's a U-2 spy plane. The Americans deny that spy planes are based at Mildenhall and were clearly discomforted when we filmed this one landing. But according to the official Air Force magazine, there are 66 support staff at Mildenhall to operate the plane's backup electronic equipment. And America's most modern spy plane, the SR-71, is also a frequent Mildenhall visitor, according to another magazine, Flight International. On the tarmac at Mildenhall, we also saw two intelligence planes of the type used to retrieve films from America's spy satellites in space. To many American military planners, then, Britain is the unsinkable aircraft carrier. Their forces here have five strands: a nuclear strike force, electronic spying, communications, nuclear weapon stores, and anti-submarine warfare. Some experts believe that all this gives them the option of confining any nuclear war to Europe. Former Admiral Jean Larocque spent 7 years as a strategic planner in the Pentagon and is now the director of the Center for Defense Information in Washington.
Oh, certainly, there's any question. If there's a trade-off, we'd rather trade the Russians London or Bonn than we would to trade Washington or Boston. There isn't any question about that, and that's just the nature of international politics. That's one of the reasons, too, that we are pushing the people of Great Britain to accept more of our nuclear weapons, which will be totally under U.S. control. And of course, if the Soviets want to knock them out, they'll be firing at targets in the Soviet Union or in the United Kingdom rather than at the United States.
But how many of those targets are there in Britain? TVI's own investigations show that the Americans now occupy more than 100 sites, mostly as tenants of the RAF, which explains why they're still listed as RAF bases. And there's a marked reluctance to give details of the bases, even to MPs. Bob Cryer is the Labour MP for Keighley.
It's extremely difficult, blood out of a stone, because you can put down, say, one question asking for the number of bases there are. You don't get a straight reply, and I had to put down three or four questions before I got the total of nearly 50 bases in this country, because they exclude bases that are partly operated by the Americans, or bases that aren't wholly manned, or whatever. And instead of giving a full and complete reply, which that ought to be the principle of government, we are elected there to scrutinize the government and seek information, they deliberately try to shield it.
But using published documents like the American Department of Defense accounts and the Air Force Property Guide, by looking at the publications of the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, and checking with agencies like the International Telecommunications Union, we were able to supplement the list Mr. Cryer was given. Would he be surprised to know that our total was more than 100?
It would surprise me very much to know, because my questions were designed to obtain that information. And if that sort of figure is the real figure, then in fact the government have been deceiving Parliament.
But Owen Wilkes of the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, who's made a study of the US presence here, disagrees.
I don't think any of the bases are really concerned with protecting Britain in any way. They're all for, they're all in rear bases, you know, for fighting wars in other places. But I think they do make Britain a much more likely target itself, because if an enemy wants to destroy the US capability to fight, one very good way is to wipe out some of these key bases which are located in Britain.
So what really goes on? TVI's investigation began at Croughton in North Ants. According to the Ministry of Defence, Croughton is an American communications centre operated with the full knowledge and agreement of Her Majesty's government. And that's all they'll say. Surprisingly, the Americans allowed our cameras to see something of what goes on behind the top security doors. The first time the installation had ever been filmed.
Go ahead and order it, 03JE.
Well, from what you've told me, no.
80% of America's defense communications are transmitted by satellite. Most go through Croughton.
Layout for your track 35 at Hayford.
It's a switching center and relay point, handling intelligence data and commands going from the United States to its weapons systems throughout the world. It has open phone lines and high security scrambler circuits, ordinary teletype and digital code transmissions. This they will talk about. But all they'll say about the radio domes in their grounds is that they're civilian, and that could mean anything from the Defense Communications Agency to the CIA. Croughton's importance as a target is emphasized by another of its roles, collecting weather data from all over the world, some by eavesdropping on Russian radio communications. What they won't say is why they want it, but one obvious use would be to correct the targeting information in ballistic missiles to allow for wind.
Russian weather data that's coming in over one of our weather intercept radios, this gives sky condition, winds, weather, pressure, temperature. Like, for example, this station here is Moscow. It says it's overcast sky conditions. The winds are from the south-southeast at 2 knots. Visibility is good, no weather. Temperature at 8 degrees centigrade.
Yet another vital communications facility is at Edsel. It's housed in an isolated village on the east coast of Scotland, shrouded by mist and by secrecy. Once again, the Ministry of Defense will only say that it's an American communications center. It is. But it's also the center of America's electronic spy network in Britain, listening to Russian communications and pinpointing targets. Owen Wilkes explains.
Edsel and the other stations around the Atlantic Ocean can pinpoint any enemy ship out in the middle of the ocean, so that the United States can, without even seeing the target, send a cruise missile hundreds or thousands of miles to destroy it.
The sign outside says restricted area, but further clues to the Edsel facility have already been published in the US Congressional Records. Edsel, it says, can listen for American and foreign broadcasts from all directions. Officially a NATO operating base, Macrahinish on the Mull of Kintyre.
The Americans don't exactly advertise their presence at RAF Macrahinish on the west coast of Scotland. But then, neither does anybody else for that matter. This station, one of the biggest in Britain, stands almost deserted, its vast hangars empty. So what then does go on here? Well, the Americans will neither confirm nor deny the commonly held belief that in this sinister enclosure behind me, there's a vast arsenal of nuclear weapons. But then, as one of their spokesmen said, there's very little point in having aircraft that can be armed with nuclear weapons unless you have the nuclear weapons somewhere.
Macrahinish has been described in congressional testimony as an airfield which is used by the US Navy's marine reconnaissance planes, which are going out to pinpoint the locations of submarines and, in the event of a war, destroy them. And if there's nuclear weapons stored at Macrahinish, these would be the nuclear depth charges which are used by those planes.
The Americans have seeded the world's oceans with a vast array of underwater microphones linked to computers. These can distinguish the noise of a submarine hundreds of miles away. An early warning chain stretching from Greenland to the Shetlands acts as a sort of doorkeeper, giving the first indication that a submarine has sailed into the North Atlantic. It's then that Brodie takes over, its undersea microphones fanning out in every direction.
These microphones are picking up noises from submarines which can be anywhere in the North Atlantic. But I think the capability provided by Brody and the other stations around the North Atlantic seriously threatens the Soviet nuclear deterrent force. And this is likely to be very unstabilizing if the Soviet Union becomes paranoid about the insecurity of its submarines. It could happen that the Soviet Union decides to launch a quick nuclear war first in the hope of getting all those missiles launched before their submarines are destroyed.
We compared our map of the American bases in Britain with the Russian map. The Russian map has obviously been compiled from intelligence data and is considered by analysts to be in effect a targeting map. When we superimposed the information from the Russian map on our map, we found it was not only Brody that was a potential target. So were the majority of the other bases.
Cruise missiles contribute absolutely nothing to the defense of the United Kingdom. One should not be deceived about offensive weapons. Cruise missiles are offensive weapons. They're not defensive weapons. And as a matter of fact, they make a nuclear attack on the Soviet or on the United Kingdom much more likely, because the Soviets will feel that they better knock out those cruise missiles which are coming into the United Kingdom, which have the capability of reaching the Soviet Union.
This glossy pamphlet was published this year by the Ministry of Defense to reassure the people who live where the missiles will be based. It points out that they'll be driven away from their bases at Greenham Common near Newbury and Molesworth near Northampton in times of crisis to prevent a direct attack. The ministry concludes that these bases will not be priority targets. However, the Home Office disagrees. Last month, they staged Operation Square Leg, a mock nuclear attack on Britain. Information which came to light during TVI's joint research with the New Statesman showed that Greenham Common and Molesworth were judged by the Home Office planners to have been wiped out in the first attack. The rest of the bases on our map didn't survive long either. I put this point and other questions about the cruise missiles to Mr. Francis Pym, Britain's Defense Secretary, and asked him first what the Russians would be likely to think of the decision to base cruise missiles in Britain.
The Russians will make this of it. If we had not taken that decision, there would be a gap in our defenses, there would be nothing for the Russians to negotiate with in theater nuclear forces, and they would know that our old capability was no longer effective. And of course, it was for that reason that they took a lot of trouble to try and knock NATO off course, to try and prevent NATO taking this decision. That's what they would think about it.
When you made your announcement about cruise missiles in the House of Commons, you spoke of the Warsaw Pact countries having a 4-to-1 superiority over NATO in land-based missiles, long-range theater missiles. Wasn't that in fact slightly misleading?
I was discussing the position as it is. It's a 4-to-1 superiority now, and we aren't in any way planning to match them weapon for weapon.
But it's only a superiority in land-based weapons, isn't it?
Yes, that's right.
We have the retaliatory capacity in our other weaponry.
Yes, but the cruise missiles is a land-based theater nuclear force, and I was comparing like with like. There are other aspects of it as well, of course, but it is still a superiority on that other side. And in with these cruise missiles, what we are doing is to replace one-for-one nuclear weapons that we have now with updated weapons.
But if you replace them one-for-one, surely that makes nonsense of the 4-to-1 superiority with which you justified the decision to put the cruise missiles there in the first place. Yep. The numbers didn't matter.
No, but it is still true that the land-based theater nuclear weapons are 4-to-1 in the Soviet Union's favor at the moment. That is a correct statement of fact.
Can we turn to the potential use of the cruise missile? 5 months ago in the House of Commons, you said that its use would require a joint political decision by the governments of the United States and Great Britain. But given that the missiles themselves are under US control, isn't it clear in any sort of emergency whose finger would be on the trigger?
No, this is an agreement reached many years ago, and it's been supported by every British government since and every American administration. Joint decision is quite clear, and that remains.
Can't you envisage a scenario in which there isn't time for that sort of political discussion, that in fact there will be a general's figure on that trigger and he'll use it?
Well, I'd simply say that this arrangement between allies is one that's lasted for ages And we've got absolute confidence in it. And if you get a bolt from the blue situation, and, you know, with only minutes' notice, well, you're in a very, very dangerous situation anyway.
In the House of Commons, and again in the pamphlet that the Minister of Defence issued relating to cruise missiles, you say that they'll be deployed in the countryside if ever they were to be used. And you say that the peacetime location, therefore, of the cruise missiles is not likely to be a primary target. Yet during the recent civil defence exercise in Britain, Operation Squareleg, the villages of Greenham Common and Molesworth were shown to have been wiped out in the first attack. Now, either you're right or the Home Office is right.
They simply used two places as part of the exercise. The reason why, I say, the bases aren't particularly vulnerable is this, that in time of tension, or if there's the slightest possibility of their being used, they drive out from their bases up to 100 miles in different directions to places, the location of which nobody knows except the crews.
But you could drop a concentrated attack of nuclear weapons on that 100-mile circle.
Of course, and anywhere else, of course. The Russians, let everybody understand this, can annihilate Britain easily, 10 times over.
This year, MPs debated nuclear weapons for the first time for 15 years. Mr. Pym said then he wanted to do everything possible to explain defence thinking.
And I think it's very important to put before the British people, and I do my best to take every opportunity to do this, what is the thinking behind our defensive strategy and how it works. And remember, it has kept the peace for 30 years.